Welcome everybody. Today we have a little different video. I've been away for a little bit. I wanted to get back into some of the AI that originally sparked my interest in computer programming back in the day. And I thought there was no better way to do that than breaking into reinforcement learning. So what I wanted to do in this video is I wanted to visit reinforcement learning. Now I've talked about supervised learning in another tutorial where we classified hand-drawn digits. And reinforcement learning is the exact same idea, except you don't know the answers to the problems. In your typical supervised learning examples, you may have a picture of a cat or a dog, and you know the correct answer. Your network makes a guess, and you can correct it based on that guess. Reinforcement learning, on the other hand, you can look at examples like OpenAI's algorithms playing video games, Tesla's self-driving cars, or things where we don't have the answers right away. For example, in video games, what is the correct answer of what to do in this exact frame of the game? It's hard to say. We don't know the answer. So with reinforcement learning, we can set up a reward system to teach our AI to be better based on their performance. I thought this would be a simple and fun project. So I wanted to start with a very basic example, or at least I thought a basic example, and I already had this simple space shooter game that I had developed with a student I was tutoring. He wanted to get into designing video games, so we created the simple space shooter that you see in a lot of YouTube tutorials with some changes. We used more class-based system just for educational reasons, and we implemented a lot of randomness into the game, so I thought that would be perfect to train our network. So although the game looks very simple, there are just 5 enemies that reappear, and when you shoot an enemy, it will regenerate at another random location. The movement and velocity of each enemy is random, so sometimes enemies will come straight down the screen, other times they will move to the left, other times they will move to the right, but they're always moving towards the bottom. If the enemy gets to the bottom of the screen, it will reappear at the top of the screen and the game continues. You can only lose if the enemy touches your spaceship. So the idea was, I'm going to try 3 of the most popular algorithms and hook up our simple environment to them, and then we'll run a quick side-by-side showdown at the end of this video, along with a 4th completely random agent. The random agent is going to have no training and just do random actions throughout the entire game. A single death ends the agent's game, and they're eliminated from the competition. I wanted to do a neuroevolution of augmenting topologies. And as you can tell, I could barely get through saying that. I'm gonna refer to it as NEAT from now on. You've probably seen these done in tutorials before if you've ever watched any YouTube reinforcement videos. You've seen Tech with Tim do it with Flappy Birds, and I believe Code Bullet also did a Flappy Birds version. And it's the one where you see a lot of games spawn on the screen at once. So we hooked up our spaceship game to that algorithm. It was fairly simple. Now, as you can see here, with our NEAT algorithm, I wanted to pass in the exact coordinates of each enemy and the velocity because I thought it would be easier and the network would be impressive and you guys would all like and subscribe to my video. Now, maybe a little karma here, but that completely backfired and this network was absolute shit. So we hook up this algorithm, we add a couple functions inside of the code, and just like that, we went from a Pi game to a fully automated and hopefully learning network. And as you can see, the results were pretty impressive at first. Right out of the gate, our algorithm scored 30 points when I generated 20 or so spaceships or instances of the game. And I could tell right away that this is going to be a very successful and very popular video. So with that, I went ahead and called it a night and let this run. I awoke the next morning, just like Christmas, ran downstairs to check my computer, opened it up, and as you can tell from this next run, after 999 generations, my AI has learned to hide in the corner. I decided it just needed more time. As these generational algorithms work, they generate over time, picking out the strongest of each generation and breeding that generation to create the next. So I figured we'd give it a couple more days and see what happened. I let it run and run and I never got any better. So I did the responsible thing and I completely trashed the entire Neat algorithm and moved on to bigger and better thing. So as my frustrations were mounting, I decided to grab a couple adult beverages and head down the deep, dark path of DQN. Code Bullet, I'm gonna teach myself DQNs. Do you have any advice?
I've seen shit, I've done shit, shit you couldn't even imagine. One doesn't simply learn Q learning.
Okay. So as I decided to head down the path of DQNs, I decided to take a little detour and visit OpenAI's algorithm section. Now I wanted to use their already developed baseline algorithms for DQN and PPO. That way I knew if my environment was the issue or if the algorithm itself was the issue. Now, OpenAI has a fantastic playground. They give you environments like these to test your algorithms on. And while that's fine, it's not very exciting. Not that our space game is. Now, I found with stable baselines, I could use a structure for an OpenAI gym and format my space game to fit inside that gym layout. And then I could use it with the built-in baseline algorithms for DQN and PPO. So first up was our DQN network. So for those of you who haven't had any experience with DQN networks, don't, just kidding. But if you do, they can be very finicky. So they are very subjective to hyperparameters. So these networks all have certain parameters that you can play with to change how they learn over time. With DQNs, there's a learning rate, there's also an epsilon value and a bunch of other items that you can change. The main idea of a DQN is it looks to improve a Q function that predicts a particular state in the game. So it picks out a frame of the game and it calculates what the reward would be from that current frame in the game and then makes decisions based on that. Now, so it learns different things in the environment. It spends some of its time exploring the environment and taking random actions just to figure out what things do. And it takes another portion of its time doing the actions that it thinks is correct. So in this algorithm, I train this DQN network to over 10 million time frames, slowly do less and less random actions to give me a model at the end of it that could play this space game. Now, one of the most important decisions that we had to make is how do we reward our spaceship? As we can see from our Neat algorithm, which I messed up the reward function, I was giving it a reward just to survive because I wanted it to learn over time to avoid the enemies. But what happened is it just hid in the corner and tried to just survive by not moving at all. So I reworked my reward algorithm altogether. So every frame, I decremented the reward by 0.001. So if nothing happened that frame, I took away 0.001 from the network. Now what that caused it to do was to take actions to actually receive rewards. So it wouldn't sit idle anymore. Now another kind of subtle change I made to the reward scheme is I also decremented 0.001 from the reward for every bullet it shot. This way it wasn't just spamming bullets like crazy. Even though that doesn't really affect the game, I wanted it to hold the bullets until something was in front of it to make it more efficient at hitting enemies. Now of course I had to give it some positive feedback as well, so I gave it a single point for every enemy it hit. Simple. This reward function proved to be pretty effective. Now, I also took away 2 points when the spaceship was touched by an enemy, which ends the game. I had everything set up. Now, I will note, as smooth as this sounds, I did take me several attempts in several dark code bullet style moments where I thought I wasn't going to complete this project in general. This is not an easy task, even when you're using an algorithm that is already being used as a baseline. So I went ahead and started training my network. Now, originally I started on my local PC and I quickly realized that we were going to have some issues in performance there. I do have a GPU, but it's a low-end GPU on my laptop, and the calculations were simply taking too long. So I moved over to a cloud server, not a sponsor, but if you would like to be, hit me up. I use Linode, they have some high-end GPUs, so I moved my program over to one of those GPUs and trained the DQN because I thought that would be the best network. Let's not waste any more time. Let's jump in and watch our head-to-head battle. Now, as you can see here, on the left side, we have our random network. We set that up to show a baseline, and you can see here, this is its best game out of 1,000, and it still got into the 30s. So it's important to have that baseline to know that, hey, that isn't that great. I would have thought that was a decent score for one of our train networks. In the middle, you can see the DQN. Right now, these are both going the exact same speed, the DQN and the PPO. And it's very clear that the PPO network is way more aggressive in its attack. You can see our randoms already finished. I kept some stats along the way. It ended up with an average of 7.4 and a max score of 34 points. I'll show you how all 1,000 of these scores break down after this head-to-head matchup is complete. You can see here we're actually going to start speeding up the DQN network because it's so slow compared to the PPO, so keep in mind these are still the same difficulty level, but we're going to speed up the DQN. We changed up the inputs to these networks as well. We used what's called frame stacking to pass the actual image of our game into our network. Now we passed several images, including a couple from history, so the network could tell which way the enemies were moving and how fast they were moving. You can see that despite the training, the networks still have some mistakes and perform some silly actions. You can see them missing a lot of shots still and wasting some movements. I think this is inevitably that just our network needs more training. The DQN I trained with 10 million time steps. The PPO I got sick of waiting and actually only trained it for 5 million time steps, I believe. Both of these could have been trained more. Reinforcement learning in general is pretty sample inefficient, so it takes a lot of training and a lot of time even to complete simple tasks. And that can be difficult when you're either paying for cloud services to train your network, or even worse, waiting for your local PC to finish training a network. You can see here that both networks have made it into the hundreds. And the PPO is still climbing at a faster rate, despite the DQN video feed actually being sped up. You'll notice the PPO network is definitely avoiding enemies. Well, they're both definitely avoiding enemies, choosing to go around. The PPO is just staying way closer to the actual incoming enemies to be able to score faster. I think if you invested some more time in training these models, you could get them to the point where they wouldn't lose. And here you can see our final scores. The DQN ended up with an average score of 19.85 and a max score of 154, and the PPO network ended up with the highest average and the highest max score at a 24 average and a max of 175. As you can see from this graph here, we clearly improved the average score with both of our networks, but you can see they're still having some bad runs. Both networks still had some games where they scored zero, but you can see clearly that they pulled the highest scores way out of the range of the random network. Check out this GitHub if you'd like to continue training. If you have any questions on running the code or the video or suggestions for the next video, please join our Discord. The link will be in the description below. I'm live there. You can chat with me anytime. And until next time, keep coding.